So if you look at diversity, what is diversity? I'm going to speak about whether it does it really matter? What is the status of diversity in critical care medicine today? And what is really the way forward for us? Now, if you ask me what is diversity, by definition, it's a condition of having many different elements. Now, when we talk about diversity, it's not only about gender. We are talking about having people from different geographical regions, ethnicity, sexual orientation, people from different socioeconomic backgrounds, multi-professionalism from different academic fields, cultural and religious. And this is what we really mean by diversity. It's not just about gender. So does this really make a difference? Why are we talking about diversity? Among clinicians, it gives you a different perspective. There can be a better understanding, increased creativity, and also productivity and improved decision-making when you have a diverse team of clinicians. What about with respect to patients? Does it make a difference? We have enough data to support that it facilitates better communication. It improves patient satisfaction with care. And it's also been seen that patients, providers from underserved, underrepresented minority communities are more likely to serve patients from underserved backgrounds. And in the academic settings, what's most important is work produced by diverse research teams, maybe of higher quality and more impactful than those produced by a lesser diverse team. So definitely we have data to support that this is really important. And I'll give you a few examples of some published data. Now, this is a very interesting survey that was conducted in the United States by the California Medical Board. Almost 50,000 physicians were interviewed. And what was really interesting is they looked at the work preferences among these physicians. And they found that minority physicians were more likely than their counterparts to work in underserved communities, to care for minorities, poor and uninsured patients. This really means that we need to improve healthcare for underserved communities through continued efforts, and we need to increase physician diversity, and this is extremely essential. And there's lots more work on that. If you look at just patient-centered communication, ratings of care, this is another survey, and this was done in 15 urban centers, again in the United States. And what they did is about 250 adults, and these were both African-American patients and white patients, and these were receiving care from 31 physicians of different races. And what the African-American patients who visited the patients of the same race found that their medical visits were more satisfying, participatory, than when they saw physicians from other races. So there was race concordance. So definitely increasing ethnicity among physicians may be one of the most direct strategies to improve the healthcare experiences for members, especially of these ethnic minorities. And more recently, you have more and more about satisfaction and communication between races and ethnicity when there is concordance. And this was a nationwide study that was conducted in the United States. And they looked at, the question they asked is that, is doctor-patient race concordance associated with greater satisfaction? And it was interesting to see that among each race and ethnic group, respondents were reported greater satisfaction with their physician when there was race concordance. And these findings definitely suggest that we should increase the minority physician. But I think the more important message from this finding is that you should improve the ability of physicians to interact with patients who are not of the same race. And this will really be the way forward in this area. How about nursing? Now, this is a very interesting survey that was published, and this was done in Europe among European intensive care nurses, and it looked at nurses across 15 countries, more than 500 nurses, and they looked at cultural competency among nurses. Does this really change and make a difference to patient care and patient satisfaction? And what they found is that nurses who were exposed to cultural diversity in different ways, had multicultural exposure or spoke a second language or visited other countries, they can actually influence the cultural competencies. And they definitely felt this was a very important part to have multicultural clinical practice and encourage this among the nurses. Now, what about doctors and fellows? Now, this is a study that was, where they looked at data over 10 years from 2004 to 2014. And they looked at diversity in emerging critical care workforce, and this was done in the United States. And they published data to create logistic regression models and compared the annual trend of representation of women and people from different races and ethnicity in critical care fellowships. And what did they find? They found that the demographics of the emerging critical care physician workforce reflect underrepresentation of women and racial ethnic minorities. And it's very important that future research is required to elucidate the reasons why there is this underrepresentation of people from racial and ethnic minorities in critical care fellowship program. And I'm sure you've all seen this paper that was published in Critical Care on women in intensive care. And Dr. Hamzavi has already spoken a lot about gender, so I'll just touch on this. And this is looking, this was an international study published by Dr. Bala Venkatesh and Dr.
Je dirige une réunion, je te rappelle dans 20 minutes à 6 heures. Ça va?
Preliminary international data on female representation in the intensive care unit. And it's very interesting. This was data from the college, Australia and New Zealand College. And if you look at the fellows or you look at the examiners, over 10 years, there has been a rise, but this has been a very slow kind of rise that has been there in the female representation. And what's more interesting is if you look at the leadership positions, if you look at people who are in councils and board members, if you look across the various societies, and this is the percentage representation of women, so there is much scope for improvement. And what really struck my attention was the presidents among the various critical care societies. And I was interested to note that ESICM has not had a single female president. And I am very proud and honored that I was elected to be the president-elect of the Indian Society of Critical Care Medicine, which will have a first female president after 28 years. So there's a lot we need to do really for the gender, but I think what it really needs is a change in the mindset, a change in the approach. We need to promote sponsorship versus just mentoring. Our mindset has to change. It shouldn't be, have you tried to apply? You should ask to be a speaker. It should be changed to, I recommend you for this speech. And we should try to encourage women to expose them to people who can help them and sponsor them and continue their growth and retaining them in critical care. I think this is very important. And this was very beautifully summarized recently by Professor Jean-Louis Basso and Francesca Rubilata in this article in Critical Care, which was published, where they looked at different methods and different approaches at various levels that could be addressed address this gender imbalance in critical care, whether it was institutional, to have change in policies, educational, increase the, narrow the pay gap between males and females. So various levels and also, concrete measures, publishing dynamics, and try to eliminate the biases that exist in order to improve narrow the gap in the gender imbalance. And this has also been published in the Blue Journal by Sangeeta Mehta. Dr. Sangeeta Mehta, who proposed various proposals on how we can address the gender parity in critical care medicine. So a lot of concrete approaches to what can be done in this area. And in 2018, the ASICM Task Force for Diversity and Equality was also established. I was very honored and proud to be a part of this committee. And this was the first draft of a policy paper for the conduct related to gender identity, age, sexual orientation, et cetera, that we looked at. And we started by publishing a statement paper on the diversity for the ESICM. And you can see over the last 10 years, how if you look at the membership, on the representation of women has increased. And if you look at the age groups, you'll see more and more younger women coming. And this is, in the next committee, and you can see the representation across various global regions and the male and female proportion. So it does leave, it has definitely improved over time, but we do have a lot of areas where we could improve the representation of women in the community. And the ESICM has formed different working groups to address various aspects of gender diversity, ethnicity, and also multi-professionalism. And I'd like to end with this very nice statement from the National Institute of Health, and where they've addressed the science of diversity. And this is a very nice article and a piece that I read, and they emphasize that workforce diversity is a scientific opportunity. And the important key points that they say is that you should identify psychological and social factors that mitigate individual and institutional barriers to workforce diversity. So the first step is, of course, to identify the problem, and then you can rectify it. And what's more important is to develop a scalable strategy so you can measure this and effectively disseminate and sustaining diversity within the nationwide scientific workforce is, I think, a very, very important agenda. I'd like to end by saying that diversity in ICU has several benefits. It gives a different perspective, better understanding. It increases creativity, productivity. It also improves your decision-making among clinicians, and it also translates into better patient care. As a critical care community, I think it is our collective responsibility to identify and address the barriers that to establish diversity in critical care. And I think future research should focus on identifying these gaps and better strategies to improve diversity in intensive care.